Can you all see the PowerPoint screen clearly?
Yes, sir.
Please give me response.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So this is the example that we discussed last week. We have two mesh and three spring system like this. And then mesh one subjected to the force FA1, mesh two subjected to FA2, D1 and D2 are the displacements of mesh one and mesh two. And then in this procedure, we first remove the spot here, right? We remove the spot so that it free to move. The motion of this spot is represented by D3 and this here this D4. We have a known force here to balance this force. That's reaction, right? Reaction at node 3, FR3, and at node 4, FR4. Suppose, let's give specific numerical values for the spring constants or spring stiffness here, okay? Let's say this is spring 1, this one. Spring constant is 6. This is 8. This is 4. Kilonewton per millimeter. That spring stiffness or spring constants. Okay. And then let's say the mass A subjected to force minus 3 kilonewton. It means to the left. 3 to the left. Mass 2 is 2 to the right. Of course, D4 and D3 is we know already because we have spot. So it's D3. And D4 is 0. This is called boundary conditions, okay? Or spot conditions. So this is called homogeneous because it's 0, homogeneous boundary conditions. So this problem is the problem of homogeneous boundary conditions. And then what we did last week is to apply, applying the direct stress method. And then we have this stiffness matrix, right? After we apply the direct stress method, 4 by 4. Why it's 4? Because we have 4 degrees freedom. D1, D2, D3, D3 and D4. But we know that D3 and D4 are zeros. Okay. This is the applied force at node 1 and node 2. This is the unknown force. So how to solve these problems? How to solve these equations, I mean? We first consider the first two rows. 1 and 2, and then we notice that the third and fourth rows are 0, so we can delete the first and second columns because this is 0, right? We multiply 0 with first column, this 0 with two columns, that becomes we can delete, okay? We can remove them, and then the resulting equation is this. Not 3 and 4. This is 3 and 4. We can remove this one. And then the resulting equation is this one. This is called reduced stiffness equations. And then the stiffness matrix, this one, is called KAA. A stands for active degrees of freedom. Okay. So this is rows. It means row 1 and 2 because it's corresponding to active degrees of freedom. This is column. Column 1 and 2, okay. This is DA, active degrees freedom. This is force corresponding to active degrees freedom. Okay. This is called reduced stiffness equation, and then we can solve it to obtain D1 and D2, okay. Using Gauss elimination. Later I will discuss it, okay, about Gauss elimination. After we have obtain the solutions, then we can use the third and fourth row to obtain FR3 and FR4. So we just we already know this, so we can use the two last rows to obtain the spot reactions. That's this the results, okay. The fourth and third rows are called constraint equations, because actually it's like constraints, right? Constraining the displacement to move at node 3 and 4. So we obtain this. Okay, this is the complete solutions of the problem. Already we have unknown displacements. This one, we have already unknown forces. What's next? Of course, we can verify our this research whether it's correct or not. First, one way to verify is by checking the global equilibrium, because the finite element solutions, a finite element solution should satisfies the global equilibrium equations. It means that minus 3 plus 2, this force, plus this one and minus this one should be zero. And you can summing up whether it's equal to zero. And indeed, it's zero. So I believe that these solutions are true or correct. Okay. So this is an important check if you perform a finite element analysis, global equilibrium equations, to make sure that your computation is correct. Okay, the second example, the second case, how about if we have non-homogeneous boundary conditions? Instead of zero, now let's say the node 3 is moved to the left 2 millimeter, and the node 4 moves 1 millimeter to the right. So the stiffness equation remain the same, the stiffness matrix remain the same, the force remain the same like this, but this one is not longer zero. How to solve this? How to solve for D1, D2, FR3, and FR4? Okay, the same procedure. We consider the rows corresponding to active degrees freedom, 1 and 2, right? This is 1 and 2. Rows and 1 and 2. So we consider the first two rows. And then we can write like this, the first two rows. Okay. This is D1, D2. This is D3, D4. Because we can separate, right? This is D1, D2 times this one, minus 4, minus 6 times this one, equals to this one. Okay. And then we already know this one. Just take it to the right, and we have this one. Okay. This one we can say we can write symbolically like this. This is KAADA like before. This I call KAPDP. Why? Because the rows are associated with active degrees freedom. So A. But the degrees freedom, the columns, I mean, associated with the inactive or passive degrees freedom. So I use this notation for this matrix. This is called DP, right? Because this is the passive degrees freedom, inactive degrees freedom. This is FA. So here from this example, we learned that when dealing with non-homogeneous boundary conditions, we must put the terms associated with the known displacement, this one, to the right side. Okay, that's the technique is like that. Okay, so this, and then we put this. This is the work in details, and then we multiply this one, we obtain this one, and then we have this one. Again, we have these equations. The solution of this equation is this one, okay, using Gauss elimination in MATLAB, for example. Okay, of course, if only 2 by 2, we can calculate manually as well. Any questions so far regarding how to obtain the solution for homogeneous and non-homogeneous cases? Please, if you have any questions. So, after we have the answers for D1, D2, and then what's next after we have these answers? We want to obtain FR3 and FR4. Again, now consider the third and fourth rows of these equations, this one. And then use that one, because we already know this, we can easily calculate FR3, FR4 like before, okay? So we use this equation KPA, DA, okay? And this is called KPP, DP, FP. And then just calculate the displacement, the matrix multiplication and summation, and then we obtain the force, this one. -4.3846 and 53846 in the unit of kilonewton, of course. Okay, the same unit, consistent unit we use. And then again, we can check whether our solution correct or not for the non-homogeneous case. And it proves here that this correct, because this is zero actually. If you sum up -3 + 2 is -1. This is -4 plus something, 4 point something, and then 5 plus something, and then this is also, this plus 1, this is -1, so 0, right? This, I think, verify our results. Any questions? So, the method that I presented to you is what so-called the matrix partitioning method. Because actually what we did is, if we have this matrix, we partition, it means separating, okay? We separating the matrix into submatrices, KAA, KFP, KPA, KPP, corresponding to DA and DP, and FA and FP. And then we solve this by considering the rows associated with active degrees of freedom, and then the rows, and then next the rows associated with inactive degrees of freedom, okay, like this. I think this is last week we have already discussed, right? We have already discussed this. This is symbolically. This is useful for programming, as I will show you today. Okay, in the previous example, what I mean of with KAA, of course, this one. Okay, this is because this is the active. This is passive, right? Inactive. This is P, this is A. This is F A, this is FP. As you can see here, right? Here is here, here is here. This one is here, passive, here is here, okay? And then this is a submatrix, like this. So this is KAA and so on, okay? This is KAA, AP, KPA, submatrix. Okay. I think it's clear, right? Any questions? This is called matrix partitioning method. It's very clear because we partition the matrix. Okay. Now let's continue our discussion with the next step after we obtain the mass displacement and the spot reactions. What should we do? Actually, what we are interested to know what the forces in its spring, okay, in its element. So here is the steps. The internal force in spring is only normal force, right? Axial or normal force like that. Okay, spring force. This is called spring force. Comparing our convention, FA1 and F2, with the convention for normal force, it's clear that the normal force is identical to FA2. How to obtain FA2? From here, right? From this equation. This is element stiffness equation that we derived last week. From here, we have that for the second row, this is FA2. This is normal. Or in other words, the normal force is identical to Fa2. From here, we know that this is Ks d2 minus d1. So from here, we know that in order to compute the internal force, normal force for each spring, what should we know? We should know the nodal displacement, of course, d2 and d1. Please think, how can we know the nodal displacement for each element? From global nodal displacement, okay? Because we already know the global nodal displacement, right? From the previous solution. For example, for the homogeneous boundary conditions, we have the solutions, right? And then by using the information contained in the M code, we know that the M code for element is 3, 1, okay? Element 2 is 1, 2, and 4, 2. That's the indicating like an address from global to local. For example, what's the content of D1, nodal displacement for spring 1? Spring 1, according to the M-code, is 3, 1. So it should take from 3 or 0, right? 0 for homogeneous boundary conditions because 3 is fixed. And then we should take from 1, okay, here. So this is copy from this one. M-code for second element is 1, 2. So just copy this one. For element 3 is 4, 2. It means 0. And the second one is 2. Any questions up to this point? Now, we already know the nodal displacement for each element, element 1, 2, and 3, or for each spring. Of course, it's easy to calculate the normal force, right? Because we already know this one. Okay. Already know this one. The normal force or the spring forces, we can compute by using this formula. Ks, the stiffness, the spring constants, for spring 1, 2, and 3, this is not n square. This is not square, right? This is normal force for spring 1, spring 2, and spring 3. This is the stiffness, the spring constants, okay? This is Ks. For spring 1, 2, and 3, this one is from here, okay? This is D2 minus D1. This is D2 minus D1. We obtain this one. Negatives, it means that the first spring in the condition of what? Compression, right? It's compressed by this force, 1.1538 kilonewton. Because the convention is like this, okay? This is the positive is in tension, right? And then the second spring tension, this is also the third spring tension. Any question?
Is positive always be in tension or sometimes can be compressed?
No. Yes. Positive always in tension because that positive negative here indicates that if positive indicates that it follows the sign notation, the sign convention like this one, okay? So if negative in the opposite direction, it means in compression, always, yes. I should say the answer is always for your questions.
Like Fa1?
Fa1?
Like
Fa1? Which one, Fa1?
Is that positive or negative?
This one? This
Fa1,
one?
A1, yes.
Of course, Fa1 is negative because it should be in equilibrium. If the force, the spring in tension, Fa1 is minus N, right? Negative. But we should notice this one because this is follows the same sign constant as N. So that's I take Fa1, not Fa2, I mean. If you take Fa1, of course you can, but here, okay? Any other questions? Here is directly normal force, not FA. Okay, not FA. This is the second rows. I take the second rows. Okay, I take the second rows of the this equation already. This one. Okay, so it's always. Any other questions? If no, let's proceed to computer implementation. So, actually, the procedure that we discussed, the directrix method, is suitable for programming. To make a program, to create a computer program, first we should think about what will be the input for the program. How about the process? The process, of course, the directrix method itself, and the results. So there are three major parts: input, process, and output. How about the input data? Can you think? For the spring problems, we need to input the, of course, first the spring constants for sure. Okay, that's material properties in general. We call the material properties. And then what else? The connectivity, right? How's the spring and mesh connect each other? That's actually geometrical data. So we need to input the geometrical data, connectivity in this case, material data in this case, just spring constants. What else? Force data, of course. What's the force and boundary conditions? That's typical for finite element, not only for spring, but for finite element, we always to give input geometrical data, coordinates, connectivity, okay, and then material data for this problem only spring stiffness or spring constants, boundary conditions or the sports conditions and force conditions or force data, okay, and then after we prepare the input data, we begin to create a program. The program for reading and echoing input data for subsequent calculation, and then we perform assembly of structural stiffness matrix, and then solving, partition and solve. We need to partition because we follow the DSM that we discuss, okay, and then compute the internal force, and then write result. Finish. This is actually the flowchart that I follow to create the MATLAB code that I will discuss here. Okay, now I am going to discuss the MATLAB code. Okay. Okay, so let's take a look at this problem again. DSM with this is homogeneous boundary condition, right? For the homogeneous boundary conditions. Okay, the input data in my book that I created a program in MATLAB, and the input data we can prepare in Excel. So in Excel we have control cards here. Control card, that's the title of the project. The project in this example, two body, three spring system with homogeneous boundary conditions. Another control number is the end of n, the number of degrees freedom per knot. Of course, is always one. So actually, this is trivial. Okay, no need to consider. The important thing is knots. How many knots? Knots in this case is the mesh. How many mesh we have? Mesh and spot. Okay, we have two mesh and two spot. So total four. We have four, right? Four knots. And then what else? Element data. This is connectivity, right? For element number one, what the material? Material is material number one. Refer to this one. What is material number one? Refer to this one. With these properties. And then number two and then number three. So these columns refer to this, okay? And then the connectivity itself is here. In my book, I call this is L naught, element naught element nodes, element node connectivity actually. Okay, this is element one. The node is 1, 3, 1. It means element one, as you can see here, element one is from 3 to 1. Is it clear? How about element two? Spring number two in this case.
1, 2, 2.
Yes, spring 2, 1, 2. Spring 3, 4, 2. Okay, this called element connectivity or L nodes. Element nodes matrix. In my book, I call element nodes. And then material is very clear. I think there's spring constants in kilonewton per millimeter. And then restraints. What the knots that we have restraints in here? What which knots are restraints? 3 and 4, right? We have spot in here. So just write 3 and 4. In what direction? In U direction. 1, it means lock, okay, with the values of 0. It means homogeneous boundary conditions. And then last, loads. The load is at mass number 1 minus 3 and mass number 2 in the unit of kilonewton. Any questions? This is all the input data, and then I create a program like this in MATLAB. Main program is this one, okay? The main program. So first, the program will ask you to input the file data. I save the Excel file in the, this is the name of the file, right? Bab 2 spring 1a dat. That's the name of the file. And then I just write here the name of the file. And then from this input, bring to here, to this function. I create a function called EchoData. What is EchoData? A MATLAB function. Do you know what is MATLAB function? Have you learned? Okay. Yes or not? Have you learned about MATLAB function? This is function like this.
Function, I think it's like to make your own syntax and perform the code so you can call back on another.
Yes, yes, a kind of subprogram, right?
Yeah,
subprogram. Subprogram. So this is from input file, and then I want to produce this one, these numbers, right? Okay, this all. For subsequent computation, okay, just read the data from Excel file. I use this MATLAB command, Excel read, okay, and so on. Okay, you can go over the program by yourself. I will not explain in details, of course. There is no time, but from here, the important thing is this one. Okay. Here, I use mcode. How to create mcode? I create mcode from the input this information, element connectivity, L nodes, and the numbers of degrees freedom for each nodes. So the mcode is generated automatically. Okay, let me show you. Okay, to show you, I think just write here mcode. And to make the program stop, I just write anything, right? Just to make program stop. Okay, and then I run in MATLAB. And then you can see the mcode. Bab 2. The name of the program is Bab 2. Actually taken from chapter 2 of my book, Spring. P stands for pause. The posteriori imposition of boundary condition. Okay, I think will be error because I type something, right? This is reading data from Excel and then you see, okay, and then give the information. The echo data is to, this is from echo data, right? The give information this one, okay. Number degrees freedom per node, total number of nodes in the structure, degrees freedom, total degrees freedom, number elements, number of nodes per element, of course two because spring. Number of local degrees freedom, it means for each spring element we have 2 degrees freedom. Element, and then how many different spring? 3, okay, 3 different spring. This is the mCode, right, as you see. mCode that generated automatically during the running of the program. Okay, using this command. A little bit complicated. This is how I generated automatically the mCode. Okay, let's delete this one. Okay, and then that's all about this one, I think. No need to save. Oh, sorry, I need to save because already changed, right? I changed already. Okay. And save. And then, any questions so far? So, the mCode is generatively automatically generated in the function of echo data. So we have mCode already here as the output, as you can see here. Okay, if you want to see the mCode, of course it's easy, just like this mCode. Okay. mCode. And then next, after we have the mCode, we can implement the assembly procedure. First, this is the global stiffness matrix. Okay, sparse, it means I will explain to you what is sparse later, but sparse, it means equal to zeros. Okay, this is, it means create a matrix with the size of number of structural variable, zero matrix, with the numbers of degrees freedom, number of structural variables. Okay, it means the numbers of degrees freedom. How many? 4 by 4, of course. Okay, and then this is assembling, assemble one by one from element one up to the number of elements. And LM is the number of elements, total number of element in structure. Okay, and this is the stiffness matrix. I use the here to define the spring stiffness matrix. Okay, to define the stiffness spring matrix is here. You can open if you want to see this function. I create my own function here. Okay, just very easy, right? Because we know the stiffness matrix for spring is very simple, like this: 1 minus 1 minus 1 1. Okay. This is just to read the spring constants. Very easy, very simple. And then the result of this procedure, let me change with zero so you can see directly what is zeros, what the result is. Okay. The result, of course, stiffness matrix. Okay, let me stop up to this point by typing anything. Anything that to make the MATLAB stop, right? Okay. mCode, stiffness matrix. Okay, this is the sample stiffness matrix. Any questions? Okay, please notice this stiffness matrix. First, this matrix is what? -8, -8, -6, -6. This matrix is called symmetric, right? Symmetric. Is it? Yes, symmetric, of course. Second, the diagonal is always positive. Later, we will learn that that's the properties of this matrix. And then, is it singular or not? Does it have inverse? Does the matrix have inverse? Please think. The complete stiffness matrix. It doesn't have inverse. Why? Because when we create this, we remove the spot, right? It means the structure become unstable. When the structure unstable, the stiffness matrix is singular. Singular, it means it's not invertible. Doesn't have any inverse. How to check it? If a matrix doesn't have any inverse, how to check it? Please give me idea, some idea. How to check a matrix that doesn't have an inverse? Can you tell me? In MATLAB, how to check it? Come on. I know you are already expert in MATLAB, right?
No, sir, no.
It's using determinant. One of the methods is to using determinant. Okay, it should be zero, right? If it has doesn't if the matrix doesn't have inverse or singular, the matrix should be singular. Believe me, the MATLAB will tell that the determinant is zero. Oh, no, this is not zero, right? Why? Let me change. This is the format, maybe format. Determinant of the stiffness matrix. Okay, very small number. It's close to zero, right? Very small number. Actually, it should be zero. By what? Why not zero, right? Maybe there is some error in computation. Okay, just merely because of the error. Or another way to check whether a matrix is singular or not by use the rank of the matrix. Have you ever learned about the rank of a matrix in mathematics? Rank? Have you ever learned? No? Yes? Come on.
I think no.
Oh, okay. So I have to explain later. But later, okay, what is rank? Oh, the rank is 3. But the stiffness matrix, the size is 4, so it's singular. Okay, it's singular. So you have to learn some linear algebra. After this, after the spring, I will give a brief overview of the linear some concept of linear algebra, because we will use the rank, the determinant, and so on. Okay. Any questions? Up to this point, let me go back to this one. Well, how to solve the equations? As you can see that I separated the matrix, stiffness matrix, into active and inactive, right? What is active and inactive? Of course, the numbers, okay? If you want to see just like this, right? What is active? What is inactive or passive? And then I just type anything to make it error, right? Otherwise, we'll run until finish. Okay, and then let me run again the program. Okay, you see? Active, there, it means the rows number 1 and 2 are just number 1 and 2, the numbers of degrees freedom, active degrees freedom, 1 and 2, and the passive is 3 and 4. Is it clear? That's active and passive. It means I take the first row and second row, and then first column and second column of the stiffness matrix, and then I take I put into the this symbol, right, or this memory in MATLAB. Okay, this is also similar, KAP, KPP, and so on. So I define the step matrix is here. And then to solve this, I need also the information regarding the inactive degrees freedom. Of course, in this case, all are zeros, right? And also FA, that's the point loss. Okay. After that, we use the formula to solve this. Okay. So this comment is to solve the equations from this one. Here, okay, KAA DA equals FA minus KAP DP. We know already this one, right? That this is unknown. So DA is equal to KAA backslash. Backslash is means performing Gauss elimination. Okay, Gauss elimination to obtain DA. Don't use inverse. Last week I taught you, right? Don't use inverse because inefficient. Okay, and then after we obtain DA, we can calculate FP easily because we know already the DA. Okay. Once we know the displacement, now the next step is to calculate the element forces. Okay, the axial force in this case, axial force for each element. So from element number one, we loop over element number one up to element number three. Okay, the number of element is three. Okay. Okay. For each element, the information is from active as well as I take the information from inactive. For the purpose of taking information for the inactive, actually in my program I define also M code. Not the M code, actually we have M code here, but I think we have another M code, right? M code for inactive degrees freedom. Is there any? Oh, maybe not yet in here. Actually, there is another M code for inactive degrees freedom. Okay, and after that, I write the results here. Write the result to Excel. That's all regarding the program. Any questions? So you can after running the program, let me run this program, okay, and then write the result to Excel. In which Excel? The initial name for the input is dot spring one a dot. The output is here, the name out, okay, output in Excel. So we go to Excel, out 1A, oh, here it is. Oh no, where is that 1A out? Why it doesn't appear? Oh yeah. Okay. Sorry. You can see the results, right? What kind of result displacement? It means nodal displacement. D1, D2. Of course, this is zero because we fix it. Okay. And then reaction, support reaction. That FA3 and FA4. And then also spring forces here. Spring 1 in compression, spring 2 and spring 3. Okay. Any questions so far? Regarding the implementation, also I can perform for non-homogeneous boundary conditions similar. Okay, the input file is in here 2A. Where is 2A dot? Okay, I have prepared the file similar, very similar, except this one. This is the same thing. Okay. Except the restraints. No. Not this one. I think 1B. Not this one. 1B. 1B. Maybe here. This one. Okay, the input data is in here for the non-homogeneous case. The same. Restraints. What's the difference here? In the previous file is zero, but here is we specify the displacement, not zero. Non-homogeneous boundary condition -2 for the spot one, spot three, spot number three, and one is for the spot number four. Okay. Then we can run the program. Just change this one. Just change the input. Not longer 1A, but 1B. And then run again. We run the program. Okay. And then we can see the results immediately. Okay, this one. Okay, reaction, displacement, reaction, and so on. Okay, so any questions? Is it nice, the program? Actually, this program can easily extend to other problems, not only Spring. Later, we will learn about bar, truss, and so on. Okay. So we begin with the very simple problem of Spring system. Why did I discuss this programming? Because I think one important aspect of the finite element method is programming. Okay, once we have formulated the finite element and then we implement it in computer. This is not for hand calculation. Of course, for Spring, it's still possible to use hand calculation, but for larger problems, it's impossible to perform calculation manually. Any questions before we discuss an alternative degrees of freedom, alternative direct stiffness method? I mean. Okay, let's start with alternative implementation of the direct stiffness method. In the previous example, we remove the spot before assembly. That's called the direct stiffness method with posteriori imposition of boundary conditions, DSMP. I call DSMP in my book. Actually, this name is original in my book. There is no in other books. Whether in English book or Indonesian book, this is I called it. Okay, I called it DSMP. I give the name. If you buy English book, I think there is no such this name. Now I'm going to discuss what so called DSMA. What is that? The direct stiffness method with a priori imposition of boundary condition. A priori, it means that on the onset, in the very beginning. We will not remove the boundary conditions at the very beginning. But let it be like the original problem. It means the spot there. Okay. This I think will give a more efficient implementation, but the programming is a little bit complicated. Comparatively more efficient. Okay. Okay, here we go. What's the difference? The same problem like this, but we don't remove the spot from the very beginning. Let's give the name for degrees freedom. For this degree freedom, this is I give D1, FA1, okay. This is T2 and FA2 like before. Here, I give different name. This is I give DP3 because this is passive. To distinguish with this one, okay, DP3 and DR3, DP4 and DR4, okay. This the name I give. The rest are the same. How about the MCOT? The MCOT also different. Actually, we can define two different MCOTs here, okay. The first one, of course, the MCOT for active degrees freedom. It means for element number one, this one. for element number one, we have local number one and two, right? Here we have local number one, local number two. But local number two is connected to a fixed value. So we give notation zero here. It means we make it inactive actually, like that. Number two is connected to one. Okay, two is connected to D1, actually this one. Okay. So this is the first element. For the second element, what the connection? This is the second element. It's one and two, right? Local one, two one, local two, two two. So it's one and two. How about number three? One of number three is fixed, it means zero, but two number three of element number three is connected to two of global number. So this is the symbol for the connection of its degrees freedom, or the relationship between the global numbering and local numbering for its degrees freedom. Any questions? What's the difference from the previous one? The previous one, of course, there is no zero, right? Here we have zero. Here, zero, zero. If we give a specified value, both for homogeneous as well as for non-homogeneous. Actually, we can also define another M-code for inactive degrees freedom like this. I called in my book is M-code P. M-code P. This is for the purpose of programming. Same, we have three elements. This is the local number. Element number one, we have only one, zero, right? This is inactive. Okay, for element number one. Oh, actually, I should call this is, sorry, maybe wrong. This is, I called P1. This is P2. Should be like this, okay? Should be like that. The numbering system, like one and two. So I called one and two, and then this is number two is zero and zero because all active. This is for inactive, right? Number three is 2 and 0. Okay. Sorry for I should revise this. This is 2 and 1. The number. Any questions regarding M-code for this method? Okay. This information of this information are very important because we will use for assembly process. So we have stiffness matrix for element number one, element number two, and number three. And then we write the M-code here for element number one, element number two, number three. This is the M-code, right? The M-code functions like an address in the assembly process. It means these rows, one and one, is this is will go to the first row and first column. Will go to here. First row and first column. That's the contribution of element number one. No others, okay? No other contribution. Here, element number two, one and two, one and two. So contributes to one and two, or. If we have an overlap, just sum it up, sum them together. This is S2, 2, and 2, and 2. For element number 3, is the second row and second column. Second row and second column. It means goes to here. And then sum with the previous one. This is become the global stiffness matrix. Now, I ask you, what do you think of this matrix? Is this symmetric? Can you answer my question? Is this a symmetric matrix? Come on. Do you know the meaning of symmetric? Hello? symmetric. A matrix is symmetric if
equal to the transpose.
Okay, symmetric of course because this is equal, right? But this is a more difficult question. Is this singular? Singular, it means doesn't have inverse. Before we know that it in the DSMP, not this one. This is this DSMA. The resulting matrix is singular. But how about this? Please think carefully. It's no, because the spot we doesn't remove. We doesn't remove the. We don't remove the spot at the very beginning. Okay, it's not singular. It has inverse. Okay, so we can use directly in the computation of the displacement. After we have the stiffness matrix, this is the unknown displacement. This is the force. Let, for example, give the numerical examples like before 6, 8, 4 for the stiffness matrix. And the force is like before minus 3 and 2. So we have these equations. The solution, of course, remain the same as this one. Okay. Next, after we have the solutions, we can go back to the element. Model displacement for element is element 1, 2, and 3. So this is 0. From this one, right? From this purpose, because we fix here with zero, and this is from the this one. This is 1, 2. Just copy, and then this is 2. Any questions? So, from this we can compute the nodal forces. The nodal forces, it means the from this equation, of course. We know that for each element, we have this equation, right? Sorry. F for each element, E, the nodal force is K, the stiffness matrix for element E, D. But we know already this one. We already know this one, right? From the previous one, this one. 1, 2, and 3. So we can compute easily the nodal force for element 1, 2, and 3. What does it mean? What the result means? What these numbers means? It means like this. For example, the spring one. Sorry. For example, for spring number one. It means 1.1538. is force in here at node 1. In which directions? Positive, it means to here. To the right, right? Because that's our sign convention. Kilonewton. And then negative, it means to here. To the left. In other words, this is the normal force, okay? The normal force, Fa2. This is Fa2 for element number 1, okay? And so, this is, I think, on the left, on the right, left, right. In other words, the normal force for spring number 1 is this one. For number 2, this one. This is the normal force for spring number 3. This is not n cube. This is not n square, but this is belong to element 1, 2, and 3, okay? Any questions? Which one you prefer, DSMA or DSMP? I prefer DSMA for manual computation because it's more straightforward. But for programming, it's more complicated. Okay. And then the problem is, what's the difference? The difference with DSMP, here we cannot find the spot reaction immediately. In the DSMP, we have the spot reaction immediately, right? But here, how to obtain the spot reactions? The answer is the spot reaction we obtain from here, from this force, okay? from element nodal force. Which element connect to the spots? Element number one, right? This one, because it's connect to number three here. So this is the spot reaction actually. Okay, I draw here. Element number one connect to the spot number three, and we have the balancing force like this, because this is actually the force x to the element is equal to the force x to the spot. That's by Newton's law, right? Action and reaction force. And then of course this is equal to F1, okay, F1 here, FR1 or FR3 one, or maybe this is just numbers getting numbering, and this is the force stress spot reaction one, and then by balance equation of element number three, we can obtain the FR4 for the spot reaction for number four. Okay, so this is the difficulty. I think one of the difficulties of direct stiffness with a priori imposition boundary condition. We cannot immediately get the spot reaction. The spot reaction are calculated later after we obtain the element nodal forces. Any questions? How about your homework? Please, in your homework, practice both with DSMA and DSMP. Both are useful. Okay. Yes, in the subsequent course, I will emphasize using DSMA because it's more convenient for hand calculation. But it doesn't mean that DSMP is not good. It's good in programming because it's simpler also. Okay. Any questions regarding two different direct stiffness methods? Actually the same thing, but just a little different in the implementation. Okay, another difficulties besides the how to obtain the spot reaction is when we have non-homogeneous boundary conditions, okay, like this. How to include this one, non-homogeneous boundary condition. We don't include this information in MCOT, of course. The MCOT remain the same. When we know the displacement at node 3, we give the code here 0. At node 4, remain 0, right? For this is for element number 3. This is remain the same. What's the difference? Okay. The difference is we notice that for element connecting to the spots, that's element number one, okay, because it connected to spot, we have these equations now. We already know this is minus two because we give information this is minus two right here. It means D, the displacement of node one local, this is one local, right, is minus two already. We have the stiffness equation for element number three. For example, we already know that D1 here is one local is one, right? 1 millimeter. So the one local D1 for element number three is one. Okay, so we know this one. And then let's do like this. We can split this one into this one. Is this correct? So make it zero. Okay, agree? And then this just as usual, we may regard it zero right here. And then how about this one? We can put out. We can take this to the right hand side because we know this matrix and this matrix. We can put this to the right hand side. In other words, we can make this zero, the minus two here, the nodal displacement, make it homogeneous. Again, the non-homogeneous equation in the element level, this is in the element level, we can make it homogeneous by taking the given displacement multiply the stiffness matrix to the left, to the right hand side like this. We take this to the right, and then we have this one, right? This multiplication matrix multiplications. Let's call this F delta for element number one. F delta means I got the equivalent nodal force at element one. Equivalent nodal force at element one due to the prescribed displacement at node three. Okay. So this is called equivalent nodal force due to prescribed displacement. Similarly for element number three, because we have two elements, right, with prescribed boundary condition element number one, and already we have element number three. We can make this zero. By, oh, this should be zero, right? Zero, sorry. This should be zero. By taking out or take the given stiffness matrix and one to here. Okay, so this is F delta 3 is the equivalent nodal force of element number 3 due to nodal displacement is this one, 1, 0 here, minus 4, 4. Okay, any questions? So basically, when you have non-homogeneous boundary conditions, we work for each element in the DSMA. Okay, move to the right, move to the right. Okay. Or in other words, we should calculate the equivalent nodal force due to prescribed displacement for each element that connected to the spots that have non-homogeneous boundary conditions. Next, well, so this is the force of element number one, element number two, and element number three, right? 12 minus 12. For element number two, we don't have any spot motions, so 0, 0. This is minus 4, for, I think from the previous one, this one, okay? This one. So the next step is we should assemble this force into global force. This is element force, element one, element 2, element 3. And then we assemble. Assembling this is equivalent to the equilibrium equations. But for this one, for this assembling, this is another terms that's called F delta. Okay. Oh, sorry. This is the F delta. This is the F due to force. So the force consists of the direct force minus 3 and 2, right, at node 1 and 2. And the equivalent nodal force, assembled equivalent nodal force due to the displacement, nodal displacement. Okay, so Fp, the direct force, and F delta. The sample of this is in balance with the nodal force, minus 3 and 2. The sample of this gives the equivalent nodal force due to nodal displacement. So this is the global stiffness equations we have. K, stiffness matrix, like before. D, this is the nodal force, Fa, and this is F delta. Way, this is the way we solve for the problem of non-homogeneous boundary condition using DSMA. Any questions? And then after this, we can calculate the displacement. After calculating the displacement, the next step is equal, is the same as before. I mean, the next step is to calculate the spot reactions, the nodal forces, and so on. Any questions so far? I think for more details, please see my book. But for now, let me show you the implementation in MATLAB. Okay, for the DSM, I created two different programs. The program one is P, it means using DSMP. Now I created another program based on DSMA in MATLAB as well. That's DSMP, maybe not in here. Yes, maybe not in here. I created two different program actually. In another program, let me show you, okay? Not in this. Here, program two, not program one, program two, okay? Here, the same thing, but use DSMA. Let's take a look at the program. The program is BAP 2 Spring A. It means DSMA. Okay. You see the similar structure? Similar, we have echo data. But you can see later in details that there is some details. Here we define two different M-codes. M-code active and M-code for passive degrees freedom. Okay, let me open the echo data. This function. I think I created M-code as well here. Oh, J-code. I didn't create M-code, actually J-code. What is J-code? Okay, let me explain. What is J-code? Like M-code, but for nodes. So in my program, I didn't create the M-code directly, but instead I use J-code. It means join code. This is member, this is join. For how many joins are there in this structure? Four, right? This is 1, 2, 3, and 4. Joins is in here is including the mesh and also the connection, the spots. So we have join 1, 2, 3, 4. What's the name of the degrees freedom for join 1? 1. Join 2 is 2. Join 3 is 3, but inactive, so I set 0, right? That's J code, similar to M code. If inactive, call 0. In addition to J code, let me explain you in the M MATLAB. I also define join code for inactive degrees freedom or for passive degrees freedom. So J code is J code P is what? The same, but this is active. This is inactive, right? So through this code, we spread to two different kinds of degrees freedom, active degrees freedom, inactive degrees freedom. Okay. So this is, I use J code. Where is the M code? The M code in this program is not in echo data. Not in echo data file, but in here. Based on the J code and J code P, I can create the M code directly in here. Okay, the M code. That's my programming way. So during the assembly, I create the M code for each element. The assembly that I must do here, not only for the stiffness like before, but also for the F delta. It means the force due to equivalent nodal force, due to the prescribed displacement. equivalent load of force due to pre-sharp displacement. So we have to assemble two different matrix, stiffness matrix and force matrix. Okay. Just the difference. And then after that, we apply the point loads and then solutions. It's simpler because we don't have to separate active, inactive, active and inactive degrees of freedom. Actually, we spread in the very beginning by using J-code, right? Then element force, like before, spot reactions, and then writing the results. Okay, I think I don't have to run this program because the result is exactly the same. So both DSMA and DSMP give the same result exactly. Should be like that, okay? So I don't need to run this program, but you can try by yourself to run this program, okay? Just type bab 2 spring A. Okay, like this. Okay, and then you can see the details of the result in the files, the same as before. What's the name of the file? This one, right? Excel file, bab 2, spring 2B, out. In the second program. Here it is. The same. Displacement, reaction, axial. Oh, I have another output here, strain energy. Okay, I give the output strain energy. What is strain energy? You know? Do you know what is strain energy for the spring? Maybe I should explain a little bit about strain energy for the spring. Well, if we have a spring, and then the spring is have deformation delta. Okay, this is less the motion of this knot is d1, the motion of this knot is d2, and then the deformation or the elongation or contraction is delta, right? Delta is d2 is defined as d2 minus d1. So this is the elongation or contraction of the spring. The strain energy is the work done if we apply external force to the spring. The spring will contain energy, will receive energy. The energy that the spring receive is called the strain energy. So if we have force, apply force like this, this is delta F, right? We apply force. For example, this is V fix here, make it zero, and then we apply force here, and then this is F, this is F delta, like this. This is the spring relationship between force and delta. This is Ks, right? S1. What is strain energy? The strain energy is the work done equal to the work done by the external force. It means the work done is, because this the force is F, Ks, delta. And then the work done is integrals from delta, let's say from zero to some value of delta here. Delta of this one. Ks, let's say this is x, just variable, okay, variable of integration, then dx. The result is, this is constants, so the integrals is 1/2 Ks x square from 0 to delta is equal to 1/2 Ks delta square. This is the strain energy of a spring, right? 1/2 Ks delta square. It means the area of this one. The area of this one, because 1/2 Ks, this is force, okay, or force times delta. Okay, because we can write like this, 1/2 Ks delta is delta, right? Delta square. What is Ks delta? Is force. It means 1/2 force, if we have F here, delta, it means the area of this one, because the area of this triangle is 1/2 delta F. That's the strain energy that I write here in the output, in addition to axial force. Why did I write here? Because strain energy is an important measure in finite element to study the accuracy of finite element later. Strain energy is one of the important concept in the finite element. Okay, any questions? Regarding the DSMA, DSMP? No? What time is it now? Almost 4 o'clock. Okay, let me continue with some examples. Who is the person to fill in the attendant list? Is he Angeline?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please fill in the attendant list for all students here. Are all students present today?
Yes, all students present.
Present. Sir. Okay. So please, I will take rest a moment. Okay, and then later I will come back. Any questions so far?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet. Have you learned the directrix method like this before? In the different context, maybe? When you learn about frame elements? Frame structures, I mean. Hello? Have you learned like this before? This method?
Nope, sir.
Really? In structural analysis too, you never use this method? Of course, in different contexts, not spring.
Structural analysis, we've ever used this method, but I'm personally forget that, sir.
Oh, So don't forget, because this is the way when you run, for example, SAP 2000. What the software do when you run structure, for structural analysis? That's actually the direct stitch method, okay? Okay, let me continue with some example before I discuss regarding some concept from linear algebra. Now, more examples about spring system. Okay, let me share again the slides. Sorry. Can you see all clearly the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's consider this system consists of three equal weights or three mass. Okay, the weight is 1 kilonewton. It means it has gravity force 1 kilonewton. 1 kilonewton is about 100 kilogram force, right? 100 kilogram force. We have three springs with the different stiffness. This is K. K is 0.2 kilonewton per millimeter. This is 2K. It means 0.4. This is 0.6 kilonewton per millimeter. Okay. Treating the springs as finite elements. Let's consider this is finite elements. Determine the vertical displacements. So the particle displacement of its weight. So when we put initially spring doesn't have any deflection, right? For example, if we consider this the first spring, initially maybe here after we put the weight, of course it will not be in here, but will be stretched, okay, to here, right? Because of the weight of this one kilonewton. But not only the spring, we also have the spring and also the spring. So please calculate the displacement when we put the weight actually like this, or more precisely like this. Initially, we have spring with no weights, maybe here. Only points, and spring again, okay, no weights. And then we put weight here, and then release. What will be the deflection, okay, from this position to this position, from this position to this position, and from this position to this position. So we don't know this, D3, maybe this is I called D2, this is I called D1. That's the question. And then the support reactions, this force, of course, to make it balance, to make the system balance, we have should have the support reaction here. Support reaction. And then the second problem. Repeat the questions. It means find the displacement and also the support reaction if we force the second weight, this one, to move 5 millimeter upwards. We force this to move 5 millimeter upwards. Okay, instead of moving downward, we force by some force, outside force, to move 5 millimeter upwards. And how much the force we need to apply to make it happen? Okay, maybe that's the questions. How to solve this? You can choose. Using the SMA or the SMP, which one do you prefer? Which one are you prefer? Okay, here for example, I use the SM board. This is the SM board. If I model like this, we release the spot. This is using the SMA. Okay. Sorry, the SMP. The SMP, because we will put the bond recognition letter, posteriori bond recognition, the SMP. Okay, this is the SMP model. And after we release the spot, we write the M code. Okay, like this. It means the matrix that contain the information regarding the connection or the relationship between global and local. Okay, it means for element number one, we consider spring as element, finite element, is connect to D1 and D2. Okay, 1, 2, element 2, 2 and 3, element 3 and 3 and 4. Okay, how many degrees freedom totally? 4. 4 degrees freedom, but not all of them active, of course, only 3 are active. Okay, because we know this D1 is restrained by this one, right? Zero, right? D1 is zero. And then the given pause here, 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 2, 3, 4. It means F2, F3, F4 is 1 kilonewton, okay? Well, the details of the solution, please refer to my book, okay? That I already give posted in the Lentera, the details of the solutions. And then after performing the directness method, again, please look at my book, okay, later. You will obtain the solutions for the displacement. Oh, maybe it's better to use MATLAB, right, directly. But the details is the data steps completion in my book, but let me use MATLAB because I already have the input data for this problem in MATLAB. Okay. Spring number two, use DSM. Here I use DSMA because I use program 2. Okay, program 2 it means DSMA, not DSMP. DSMP is program 1. The data is I think spring to A, spring to A, yes, spring to A dart. So let me open the data. Program 2, spring. Two A. Here, okay. Okay. So the node, 1, 2, 3, 4, is I think obvious, right? The element, we have 3 springs, 1, 2, 3. Materials, 1, 2, 3, because we have 3 different spring constants, as indicated in materials, right? 0.6, 0.4, sorry, 0.2. And then connectivity 1, 2, 2, 3 and 3, 4 is the same as M code actually in this problem. And then what else? Restraints. This restraint is only the spring is hang from node one, right? Hang from node one. So node one with the value 0. How about loadings? Loadings at node 2, 3, and 4. Okay, 2, 3, and 4, 1 kilonewton, 1 kilonewton, 1 kilonewton. Any questions up to this point regarding the input data? I use MATLAB for this example because I think this for the details of the direct state method, you have to do practice by your own. But I will show the result using MATLAB here. Okay. Using the SMA. Then let's run the program. The program is what? Bab 2 spring A, right? But the input data is bab 2 spring 2A, right? The axon. Okay. And then let's run the program. Bab 2 spring A, yes. Okay, this is the research. Okay, so you cannot see the, you can obtain directly, you can read directly the research here. The displacement of spring one is 5 millimeter. So what does it mean? This equal to, of course, this is zero, right? This is 5 millimeter from the MATLAB research, and then 10 and then 15. This is 10, this is 15. Before proceeding, let's ask ourselves, does it make sense for the displacement be one is 5? What do you think? Actually, for this problem, we can check using basic physical laws, because we know the spring is 3K, it means 0.6 kilonewton per millimeter, but the load is, how much is the load on not one? This one, okay, but this one, it means total 3, right? So if we consider only this spring with the total loads, okay, spring with the total load is 3 kilonewton. This is the what's the delta or the elongation of the spring according to Hooke's law? According to the Hooke's law, is equal to the force 3 divided by the stiffness or the spring constant, that 0.6, and 3 divided by 0.6 is equal to 5 millimeter. Okay, exact, right? Exactly correct. We can check easily. Is it? Yes. How about the spot reactions? We can read from the program. I mean from the Excel, not the program. Where is the Excel? Sorry. I should. What's the, which one? The Excel. Here, spot reactions, reaction. This is the displacement, reaction, minus 3. Yes, exactly, right? Because it should be minus 3, because this is 1, 1, 1. This is should be minus 3. Why minus? Because I take the positive downward. Downward is positive, minus it means upward. Okay, upward direction. That's exactly 3. What else? We can learn from these results. Axial force 3, yes, because we can check it easily, because this is 3, right? If we cut this, of course, 1, 2, 3. We cut this, the force will be 2. So cut this 1. Okay, that's exactly 2, 3, 2, 1. Correct. Strain energy we can check as well. Okay. For example, the first spring, because we know the formula for the strain energy is like this. So the first spring will absorb 1/2 K, the stiffness is 0.6, delta is 5 square, 25 divided by 2 times 2.6, or 25 divided by 0.3, right? Oh, no.
I think it should be 25 times 0.3.
Oh, yes, yes. 25 should be times 0.3, right? 25. Okay, 7.5, right? 7.5. Correct. So we can check it easily for this problem. Any questions so far? Using direct method. Actually, my MATLAB performing that DSMA, not DSMP, but this is DSMP in the picture. But the same results, if you use DSMP, whether DSMP or DSMA, will give the exactly the same results. Okay, the second problem, the second questions. This one, I force the second weight to move 5 millimeter. What the force F that we need to apply? Okay, my question is that, like that. For the second problem, what's the boundary condition? What the displacement condition? The boundary condition, yes, boundary conditions. D1 is zero, remain zero, right? Zero. And how about D3? It's minus five, okay, minus five. Because we forced to move minus five upward. The positive is downward, following this sign convention. Positive downward. I want this move upward, it means minus five here. How about the applied force? The applied force is the same as before, one, one, one. But the difficulty is at node three. What the difficulty? We apply the displacement and force at the same nodes. What do you think? Is it possible? Yes, it's possible, but we should interpret like this. Okay, for the force number three, actually still announced, the total force is announced, right? But we already have applied force at node three, and the announced part is this one, FR3, the force that we need to give in addition to the force already have. I mean like this. We already have the applied force right here, FA at node 3. That's from the weight, it's 1 kilonewton. But of course, if we only apply this force, this node or this mass will move downward, not upward 5 millimeter. Is it clear? In other words, this is should be not the only force. There is another force that we should apply. This is still unknown. I call FR3. This is we don't know, okay? We not know yet the force FR3. But we should apply it. In other words, the total force at node 3 consists of FA2, the given force, the already given force, plus the unknown force that we want to find it, okay? Is it clear? So I write here. If we have prescribed the displacement of node 5 minus 3 millimeter, then the force should be an unknown, okay? Because we determine the displacement, the force should be unknown. But the problem is we already have the force, so we should add with the unknown parts, okay? Not only this one, we have the unknown force. Is it clear what I mean? So in general, if we have stiffness equations, in general the force we can split into two: the given force FA and the unknown force. So for the second problem, this one, I mean for the second case, this one, we can solve it like this. Well, if we want to know the force, we can calculate by FKD, because this is KD minus FA. The KD is, yes. Later we can solve for D, right? Using directness method, the displacement we know, and then FA we already know. This is because the applied force, in this case from the mass itself, the weight of the mass, okay? This is the reaction, like the reaction. This is unknown reaction, this is the reaction. That's the force we need to apply. Okay, so I think this one, I already have this one. This is the I run already, sorry. I run using DSMA in MATLAB, okay, like this. This is for the second case. And for this non-homogeneous, this is for homogeneous, therefore non-homogeneous, we have like this. Which one is active, which one is inactive? This one active, right? One and two, this is inactive. So the M code for the SMA is like this: zero because inactive, one for element number one. For element number two is 1, 0. This is because we consider it's inactive. Why inactive? Because we give the displacement a number, not the force. Okay, And then F, 0 and 2. That's the MCON. If we perform the calculation using the SMA. The details is available in my book, so you can learn by yourself, but I will run the second problem again using MATLAB. Okay. It's already, I think it's better. The input file is in the Spring B, I believe. Okay, let's take a look at that file in Excel. Spring B. 2B. Where is 2B? Here it is. Input data. Okay. Control data remain the same. Okay, but the nodes remain the same. 1, 2, 3, 4. Main connectivity, I think, remain the same. There is no change. Material. Here it is. The change is in here. Before or previously, we only have this one, right? Now, in addition to this one, at node 3, we apply the constraint as well. So, made it negative or lock with the prescribed value as -1 millimeter. Okay. So, this is the U value. U, it means displacement. At node 3. Then the loads, the applied load is 2, 3, at node 2, or this is should be 3, right? Or can be like this. This is not necessarily regular. We can apply at any different order, 2, 4, 3, all are 1. Okay, let's run the program. Bab 2 Spring A, it means the program to run, I mean this one, okay, this one, to run this program, okay. Let's go. This is the results. So the result is the displacement at node 1 only is -1. The rest are 0. If not in here, the rest, it means 0. It means 0. Okay. If you want to see more details, the result is in Excel. Okay. Here. Okay. Stray energy. Axial. Reaction. Displacement. Okay. -1. -5, of course this is -5 because this is given, right? This is given already, right? This is given. And the result is -1 at node 2 and at node 4 is 0. It means node 4 doesn't move at all, right? How about the force we need to apply at node 3 to move this -5? And that's the support reaction. The force that we need to apply is, we can give the answer from here, -3.6. It means 3.6 upward. We should apply 3.6 kilonewton upward to make the mass move 5 millimeter upwards. Any questions so far? Regarding the second example here. So again, if we apply a displacement, we prescribe the displacement at one node, the force should be unknown. Okay. How about if we already have the force, we should add with unknown force. We cannot apply the force and the displacement at the same location. It means without unknowns. We cannot do like that. Okay, so if the force is unknown, the displacement should be given or contain unknown. Okay, but if we give the force, the displacement is unknown. So we cannot set displacement 5 millimeter and the force some values without a nouns. Okay? Do you understand what I mean? We cannot specify false and displacement at the same time, at the same location, sorry. Well, the time is almost up, but let me give you an overview. I think next week does the details of this one, these concepts. We see that the resulting equations from the direct stiffness method is this one, right? Stiffness matrix, nodal displacement, force. Okay, always like this. What are these? Actually, this is a system of linear equations. System. Oh, very bad. I don't know how to. This is error in my computer. Sorry. System of linear equations. So in order to understand these equations, for example, the concept of rank of matrix and so on, inverse, Gauss eliminations, I think we need to learn some concepts from linear algebra. So I think because the time is up, we will continue with these topics next week. Okay. Any questions up to this point?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet. So if not yet, how about the homework? Any difficulties regarding your homework? When the homework due? Next week, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any difficulties regarding the homework? Or not yet? Not yet. Try.
I haven't tried.
Okay. Please try my MATLAB program. You can check your homework, manual calculation, and then use my MATLAB program as well. Okay. To check it. So my MATLAB program can be used for checking your computation. Either using DSMA. I think I have uploaded the MATLAB program, right? Or not yet? I forgot.
I don't think so, sir.
Oh, not yet?
Yeah.
Okay, later I will give you all for free, okay? So for those who attended the finite element, my finite element course, I always give free program. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
So see you next week. I hope you can submit your homework, and then I promise I will upload the MATLAB course for you for checking your homework. See you.
Thank you, sir. See you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Okay.